One characteristic example of these participatory projects is the Tupperware Project, an ongoing series of exhibitions and workshops which travels worldwide, visiting various locations and venues. Collaboration with museums, organizations, universities, foundations, and even military camps, the activities take various forms and follow a different plot each time, inviting participants to fill plastic food containers, commonplace domestic receptacles that were nonetheless highly prized within refugee camps, with artworks and symbolic objects. The final goal of the project is to construct a mock-up wall at the Green Line with all the stuff the Tupperware Project produced, replacing parts of the existing barriers. Most of these haphazard improvised barricade structures were hurriedly assembled from empty oil barrels filled with concrete. Now, 32 years later, these rusting barriers are sad, potent symbols of an apparently unsolvable dispute. The Tupperware Plastic Monument, as a collective political gesture, is going to be a fragile plastic wall that declares the strong will of people and artists from the entire world for a peaceful reunification of the island. Motivating people to participate in political interventions is not easy. Based on my experience, during leisure times, people are more available to listen and more eager to collaborate. Usually, their participation takes the form of a collective game, a long-term performance, or a Dionysian ritual.
But I was yours and you were mine. Summertime in Prague, when blood was warm, when blood was young. After all those tears, after all those years, I long for summertime in Prague. We were so rich without a dime. When I was your queen and you were my king, without a palace, we would sleep in cheap hotels and wake up from the sound of bells on Sundays. We would only drink cheap wine, but I was yours and you were mine. After all those tears, after all those years, I long for la 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 la.
Evidently, nonchalant summer resorts, playgrounds and luna parks, fetes, festivals, and any kind of public celebrations are the perfect battlefields for the rambling museum's manifestations. Currently, I'm in the process of working on another transformation of the museum, especially for an intervention at the next carnival parade in the Greek town of Patras, which is currently the cultural capital of Europe. Technically, it's going to be a replica of Mies van der Rohe's monument to the November Revolution, which he designed for the city of Berlin in 1926, as a memorial to Karl Liebknecht and Rosa Luxemburg, and was destroyed by the Nazis during the 1930s. The whole idea has to do again with the wall. From the very beginning, Mies' intention was to make a wall which was reminiscent of the wall in front of which the communists were executed. As most of these people were shot in front of a brick wall would be what I would build as a monument, was Mies' exact statement. The CIA believed the suppressed message of Mies van der Rohe's monument, and fearing an ongoing discussion, had its plans destroyed. As one of the primary architects of post-war corporate America, Mies' association with communism in the 1920s made American industry nervous.
Good day.
The Mies van der Rohe Monument is one of a series of destroyed architectural icons that I have referenced. In 1990, I constructed the facade of my museum as a replica of the glass partition of the Barcelona Pavilion. In keeping its dimensions and morphology, I thought that I would make the perfect Bauhaus show window to frame the ugliness of a decaying neighborhood, much like mine. Since then, this glass facade of the Rambling Museum has provided the framework for many projects. In 2004, for example, the glass facade was transported to take part on a carnival float, accompanied by a faithful replica of the cage contrived by the US Army for the Taliban prisoners at Guantanamo Bay in Cuba, and subtly referred to as the Cabanon of Le Corbusier. Visitors were invited to enter the cage, which was linked with an elevator machine, giving them the possibility of a symbolic rise to a height correspondent to that of the Parthenon's columns. Russian constructivism and Lenin's elevators for the communist propaganda were my source of inspiration for this kind of public protest machine. I interpreted the partitions that Mies van der Rohe had inserted in that pavilion without any structural function in mind, and especially the freestanding onyx wall in the center, as an allegory of the uselessness and absurdity of the dividing wall in Cyprus. Focusing on this wall, I finally decided to pull it down. Another construction that functioned as a public protest mechanism was the Banner House that I constructed for the Public Garden of Athens. The central wooden construction followed in scale the outline and the ground plan of my house. while, according to the usual ritual, some original structural elements from my apartment were incorporated in the installation.
Και έφυγε αυτό που θέλαμε.
Ναι.
Αλλά όχι. Μισό λεπτό.
Είναι το πιο σταθερό αυτό, καταλαβές.
Είναι σκάλα. Σκάλα, σκάλα, σκάλα. Είναι σκάλα.
Στο διάδρομο εδώ.
A fabric alternative of the Banner House was at the service of the audience. Placed in different locations around town, at public squares, and even in the room of a central hotel. A similar full-size protesting placard is one of the constructions that I'm currently working on for the Patras Carnival Parade.